up now with a three-on-one break. Blocked by Alonzo Mourning.
Wow.
And Mourning repels a Hakeem Warwick dunk.
Hey guys, this is Dominique Wilkins.
Hey, this is Sean Kemp.
This is Gary Payton.
Hey, this is Pau Gasol.
NBA fan, what's up? This is Vince Carter here.
Hey, what's up? This is Matt Barnes. If you're an old school NBA fan like I am, make sure you check out the Basketball Time Machine with my man Sean David.
Hey guys, what's good? Welcome back to the Basketball Time Machine. My name is Sean David. Thanks for tuning in. In today's episode, I want to take a look at some players, some NBA legends that kind of got forgotten over the time and don't get the respect that they actually deserve. So I'm not saying the guys are completely off the radar, but they just deserve way more love. But before we dive into today's episode, do me a favor, please subscribe to the channel and like the video if you enjoy the content. All right, enough said. Let's dive right into today's episode. So, how am I going to do this video? Well, I narrowed it down to four different players, so let's start with player number one. The first player that we definitely should show more appreciation for is Alonzo Mourning. Back in the 1990s, Alonzo Mourning came into the NBA and dominated the post in an era where almost every good team also had a good post player. Joining the Charlotte Hornets in 1992, Mourning would average 21 points and 10 rebounds in his rookie season, and also helped the team to be a yearly playoff contender for many years. What made Alonzo Mourning so special was his defensive approach. Nowadays, where literally every NBA player is getting out of the way not to be on a poster, Alonzo Mourning would be the alien. This guy would always accept the challenge and would always go for the block. And yes, he got dunked on every once in a while, but most of the times he would win those battles. He would average 2.8 blocks per game over his entire NBA career, and always be one of the best defenders in the NBA. If it wasn't for Alonzo's kidney disease, I am 100% sure we would be talking about a top 100 player of all time. Not many players played with so much intensity like Zo. When he joined the Miami Heat in 1995, he gave them a face and a new identity. One of the most feared teams of the 1990s.
When our defense ended, he was the guy who stopped and made the play. He was such an intimidating force in blocking shots.
He came into Georgetown as a raw, athletic, shot blocking center, and you see his game progress.
Mourning, the shot, good!
Alonzo Mourning, the biggest shot in Charlotte basketball history.
It's big time.
The Miami Heat began to embody all those qualities that Zo already had.
Right down Main Street, turned away by Alonzo Mourning.
Is there a better basket area defender on the planet? I don't think so.
The next player that we definitely should show more love to is Grant Hill. Now with Grant Hill, because of the fact that he played 18 seasons in the NBA, 10 of them being post-injuries, it's easy to forget how great he was in his prime. Now let me take you back to the mid-1990s. When Michael Jordan had retired for the first time, Grant Hill was supposed to carry the torch and was considered to have the biggest potential of any NBA player. Hill could literally do it all. He was a good defender, a good passer, a good scorer. Simply put, he had the complete package. One problem he had, though, was that his team, the Detroit Pistons, were, well, not good. It was a one-man show. This could have changed when he joined the Orlando Magic with Tracy McGrady. But by then, his body was already causing problems. After many surgeries, Hill was a totally different player for the second part of his career. He wasn't as explosive and also lost a lot of his athleticism. Still, he would play for 10 more seasons as a great role player. But we have to remember how good he was in his prime.
They let him be Grant Hill and not try to compare him to somebody else.
The Grant Hill era was a strong period of Piston basketball, actually. When Grant Hill came in here, he wasn't perceived as a bad boy, that's for sure. He had a very, you know, clean-cut, wholesome image, which that's who he was.
Kid, you got the moves, you got the talent, you got a problem.
You're too nice. We'll fix that.
Okay, Mr. Lambert.
The Grant Hill era was special, you know, for a number of reasons. People always said that the Pistons have never had this
effervescent, popular superstar who was on commercials and was nationally recognized. And Grant Hill's a nationally known commodity, and he belonged to Detroit.
Now making way up for Grant Hill. Here comes the reverse jam.
That's what the fans been waiting on, George.
First thing I remember with Grant was anything he worked at, it was fluid. Probably the best off-the-dribble guy you're ever going to see in the NBA.
Grant Hill gets it on the wing. He lets it go at the horn. Oh, there he goes! And down he goes!
I think during two or three of his years here, he was as good a player as there was in the entire NBA. There's nothing he couldn't do on the basketball court.
But out of nowhere comes Grant Hill with the left hand, throws it out of here.
Grant Hill's crossovers weren't this flashy, I'm palming the ball and putting it up high and you're gonna reach for it. His crossovers were very low to the ground and he was playing against guys of like size. That's when people began to see, okay, maybe this Grant Hill guy's got a little bit of real game that he's, you know, taking it to virtually everybody. It doesn't matter what type of pedigree that you have.
But then the killer crossover. And the slam for Grant.
And the next player that I have on my list is David the Admiral Robinson. It's amazing how such a great player, who was in the NBA's top 50 list and in the NBA's top 75 list, gets overlooked when talking about the best bigs of all time. And yes, of course, he played in an era with Shaquille O'Neal, Hakeem Olajuwon, Patrick Ewing, and many other great bigs. But if we take a look at his career and his skill set, we should be talking about one of the six best bigs of all time. And yes, I know this sounds crazy at first, but let's be objective and just see how great he really was. Let me show you his career achievements. And remember, he did all of this in the toughest era in NBA basketball, the 1980s and 1990s. His athletic ability was outstanding, and paired with great fundamentals, Robinson was one of the best two-way players of all time, helping the Spurs to be a yearly title contender in almost every single season he played for them. And this was even before Tim Duncan arrived. To me, it's a mystery why hardly anybody talks about this guy. But I had to make sure that we show him some love in this video and not forget how great he was.
First down by one, Sean Elliott with four. There it is, Robinson. He hammers it home.
He was Dwight Howard before Dwight Howard ever was Dwight Howard. He was the first guy that we've seen like that, at that size, on a consistent basis.
Weber, great check by Robinson. What a play. Robinson, look out if he starts hitting that one.
David Robinson was really the first 7-foot guy who could run, who could jump. It was really quite something to behold that a 7-foot guy could run and jump like that.
What a jump by David Atope into the board.
Saw nobody between he and the Admiral, and he decided to go military with it.
And the last player on my list is Detlef Schrempf. Now, before there was Dirk Nowitzki, there was another German player who laid the groundwork. A player that had the complete package. A player that still isn't in the Hall of Fame for whatever reason, but he really should be. Detlef Schrempf was a unicorn of his time. He was 6'10", but could handle the ball and was able to play position 1-5. And no, I'm not saying that he would play position 1 throughout the entire game, but he was allowed to grab a rebound and bring the ball up the floor. He could pass, he could rebound, he could score, and he could shoot the 3-ball. He was a 2-time sixth man of the year, but probably would have been a starter on almost every team. What made him so special was that he was not blessed with athleticism, but had a very high basketball IQ. Super effective, super efficient, a super smart player. When he joined the Seattle Supersonics, he helped them to become one of the best teams that never won an NBA championship. Remember, they had to face the 1996 Chicago Bulls in the finals. And if it wasn't for them, Schrempf would have been an NBA champion. Anyway, such a great player deserves more love, and that's why he's on my list. You know, when I think about it, it's kind of funny. I think that every era has its players that are really good, really great, but kind of got forgotten over time. If it is the 1970s, 1980s, 1990s, and I think today's players will suffer the same consequence in like 20 years. But because we are an old school channel, we only cover the good stuff, so the 70s, 80s, 90s, and the early 2000s, and those were four players that I felt deserve way more love. Anyway, you guys, I hope you enjoyed this episode. Don't forget to leave a like, and even more important, subscribe to the channel and click the notifications bell so you get a notification once I upload a new episode. All right, you guys, see you next time on the Basketball Time Machine.
His legacy is one that
will go on forever.